If you'd like to take your seats, we're going to get started. Good evening. Welcome to a conversation about the potential for public transportation to transform a region. I'm Andrew Moore, and I'm an architect with the firm Glavain Holmes, and I'm also president of Partnership for Smarter Growth. And PSG and our friends at RVA Rapid Transit are really pleased to be here tonight and presenting this evening with Jarrett Walker. Our two organizations have been really working tirelessly to make sure that the new GRTC Pulse, the bus rapid transit line, maximizes its potential to be a transformative element of a new transit system for Richmond. There's a moment in time when it could be thought of as just an isolated element, but we felt strongly, and others felt strongly, that it should be thought of as a spine for a transformed system, and that is what Jarrett Walker and his team have been working on here in Richmond. On a personal note, I really love riding the bus. I ride the number 16 basically from end to end, from University of Richmond to 12th Street, and it's part of my weekly commute. Several times a week I do that. And change is hard, and part of our conversation tonight is about how systems sometimes need to change in order to be more efficient. And it could very well be that my treasured number 16 bus, which, you know, I'm oftentimes the only rider from University of Richmond to Thompson Street, may end up, you know, changing after this transformation. But I believe that those types of changes are needed in order that the overall system can provide rapid and equitable transportation for our community. So, before we get started, I wanted to thank, first of all, you for coming, and any elected officials and candidates for office who happen to be here, thank you. We hope this will be informative for you. And I also want to thank our hardworking staff, economic development and planning department staff in City of Richmond and surrounding counties. You guys keep the wheels from falling off sometimes. Thanks to GRTC and the City of Richmond for advancing public transit in our region. And finally, I'd like to thank the Transit Center, which is underwriting this evening. They provided a grant to Partnership for Smarter Growth and to RV Rapid Transit, and are helping us be able to do what we do. Speaking of donations, all of these organizations are nonprofits that run on your donations. So anything you can do to help would be greatly appreciated. So before we hear from Jarrett Walker, I want to introduce my colleague and friend, Tripp Pollard. He's a senior attorney with Southern Environmental Law Center, and he's a PSG board member. And he's going to be providing a brief overview of kind of the local scene for transit opportunities and challenges in the Richmond region. Tripp.
Thanks, and I would also like to welcome everyone. Thank you so much for coming tonight for this very important topic. As Andrew said, I think very exciting time for Richmond, both the city and the entire region, as we look at our transportation challenges, as we look at ways to improve our transit system and our transportation system more broadly. So I'd like to give just a few minutes of some quick context and then a little bit about some of the other things going on. We're going to mainly focus tonight on the Richmond Transit Network Plan. But there's a number of other things going on of importance that we'd like to just touch on very quickly. So first, for a little bit of context, fact is we do a lot of driving in the Richmond region. We have actually the highest rate of driving of any metro area in Virginia. People are often surprised, more miles per capita than either Northern Virginia or Hampton Roads. And in fact, we drive roughly the distance to the sun every 3 days. That is a lot of driving. It's not just the driving and the amount of driving we do, it's also the really important other part of the transportation picture are those who don't have an automobile. Actually, a very high percentage of people in the city, 60% of city households, have either no car or only one car. Then when you look at the transit picture more broadly, this is a statistic that's used a lot. It's actually kind of nuanced. It's in some ways a little unfair to Richmond, but it gives you kind of the general sense of things. As a study done a number of years ago ranked Richmond 92 out of 100 of major metro areas in terms of the public transit coverage and access to jobs. Now, we've done a very good job, I think, GRTC, in running an efficient system with what we have, but I think as anyone familiar with the system knows, it's a very limited system in its geographic scope. We could have a whole separate forum just talking about the history of that and where we go from there. But it's a really important part of the lay of the land as we talk about the transit network plan and other issues along transit. Unfortunately, many of our jobs are not accessible by transit in our region today. But there are a lot of changes going on. There are changes nationwide, there are changes in the Richmond region that I think are going to really change a lot of those elements of that context. Nationwide, we're seeing enormous public interest and demand for walkable mixed-use communities. You look at this region, polls consistently show overwhelming 70-80%, depending on the poll, public demand for expanded public transit. So some of this is some generational shifts, some demographic changes, the increase in millennial generation, aging baby boomers. People are looking at more alternatives to get around, and there is just tremendous increase in support in this region for greater transit. So with those trends and that support in mind, there are some exciting things happening. And I'll touch really briefly on some of them. I'm not going to talk about the transit network plan because that's the bulk of what we're here to talk about tonight, but I do want to mention several other things. This is not an exclusive list, but just a few of the other things going on. The Pulse, Richmond's first bus rapid transit, obviously a huge step for the city and for this region. It will connect a number of important activity centers. It is going to be the, hopefully, first step in a much more regional system. It's a logical first step. Provides that important greater accessibility to jobs, which, again, will need a much larger regional system to really get to where we need to go. And it will also have another benefit, including spring economic revitalization and construction. It is currently under construction and is scheduled to open in October 2017. And that's the latest kind of map with the stops and the latest names on it. So that obviously is a huge piece of the changing transit landscape for Richmond. Another piece that's been underway, and it's part of how we're trying to make sure, I think one of the challenges with the Pulse is to make sure it's effective as we can. Part of that is looking at the surrounding land use, transit-oriented development, or TOD. And there is another study that's going on right now, looking at land use and connectivity, how we can get more residents and people and businesses around the stops where the Pulse will run, for example, so we can get the ridership up and also get better access to jobs. This plan is the product of both the City Planning Department and the Richmond Regional Planning District Commission. There's going to be a mix of long-term and short-term recommendations. It will ultimately be adopted and incorporated as part of the city's master plan, so it will come into play with future zonings and rezonings as hopefully we have much more development along the corridor. And there are going to be upcoming public meetings, so just one thing to flag for those of you coming up. In next month, there will be public meetings on this study. Another piece is the Richmond Transit Vision Plan. And many of you may already be familiar with this. This is developed by the State Department of Rail and Public Transportation, working in conjunction with the Regional Transportation Planning Organization, as well as GRTC. So a lot of players involved here. There's also been a very active stakeholder group and a lot of public input as well. So this has been in the works for a while. The final draft actually is about to be released. We'll be out for public comment next month. And the plan is to finalize this in December. And this transit vision plan, I'm sure you can't see it here, but this is the kind of working map. The red lines are just for a of particular interest to a number of you are the proposed BRT lines. So this is part of the future of how, where are we going to go. And not only that, there was also increased express bus service, enhanced local service. And this plan, in addition to that additional BRT, in addition to the local routes, will almost double the amount of population and jobs near transit. And that's just the amount who can access it. But the other important thing that it does is increases frequency much more, many, many times it increases the frequency of transit close to population and job centers. Another piece that kind of is needed as we go along and we keep an eye on this is to look at some of the land use and scenario planning around that vision plan. But the really the biggest challenge here is going to be the political challenge of getting not only the city, but this is a regional plan. We've got to get the surrounding counties on board. We've got to get funding from the state. We've got to get funding from the localities. There's going to be some really heavy lifts to making this plan a reality. But this plan is a very doable, very feasible, and very necessary component if we are going to achieve a vision for meaningful and extensive transit in the Richmond region. So, encourage you all to keep your eye out for these various plans and these various steps. That's just a quick look at some of the other surrounding trends, things that are going on. And again, thank you all for being here tonight. And now I'd like to turn it over and introduce someone who needs probably a new introduction to the vast majority of you here, Reverend Ben Campbell, who has been a primary driver of efforts to expand transit in the Richmond region for a number of years, heading the clergy committee, among others. And I will turn it over to Ben. Thank you.
Thank you. I have another kind of unpaid job among the many unpaid jobs I have, and that is being on the on adjunct member of the staff here. So I'll tell you what the pastor of St. Paul's says every time there's a meeting here. I didn't do that though, right? Did I? He says we also have some things happening here on Sunday. That would be at 9 and 11:15. I'm a board member of RVA Rapid Transit, co-chair of the clergy committee for Rapid Transit, and our RVA Rapid Transit staff is around here. You guys want to stand up and wave your hands? Ross, Nelson, Dominic, Luis. We're serious, folks. They say this Metro Vision Plan is for 2040. As far as we're concerned, it's for 2020. We need to be a real city with real public transportation. It's my privilege to introduce to you tonight Jarrett Walker. Jarrett is, and Michelle, are you here? Stand up. Michelle Pororo are working with Michael Baker Associates. Anybody from Michael Baker Scudder? Yep, back here. Which is a local firm to work with us to get this Richmond Transit Network Plan right. That is making the local routes function better, faster, more effectively in conjunction with the new BRT. So existing people have better service and new people also have service. That's the goal, and they're working hard at that. Now, Jarrett, I've got something to read here about him, but and he's our show tonight. Jarrett is an international consultant in public transit network design and policy. He's been a full-time consultant since 1991 and has led numerous major planning projects in North America, Australia, and New Zealand. He's president at Jarrett Walker Associates based in Portland, Oregon. You know, other metro cities have public transportation, and Jarrett's been working on that. And he's principal consultant with MR Cagney in Australia. He's the author of the popular public transit blog, humantransit.org. Want to write it down? And the book, Human Transit, How Clearer Thinking About Public Transit Can Enrich Our Communities and Our Lives. This book is, the author of this says, and I'm sure it's true, a friendly, non-technical introduction to transit's underlying geometry and the real value judgments that must be explored to make both transit and development policy. Jarrett's background integrates an arts and humanities PhD with long technical experience in all aspects of transit and its role in city building. He is a frequent keynote speaker, teacher, facilitator of decision-making processes. Jarrett Walker, thanks for being here.
Thank you. I'm going to actually step away from the mic and make sure that this mic is working. Are people hearing me through the mic? Excellent.
Yes.
Cool. Thank you very much, Reverend Campbell and Tripp, and you know all the great leadership we've got here, you obviously have here in the region to move forward with public transit. One of the most exciting things about my job is going from one city to the next and being able to engage with all these people who would take the trouble to come out on a nice summer or fall night and talk about transit instead of all the other things you could be doing. I roughly called this Transit Choices for the City and Region, as the Reverend mentioned. I'll be talking mostly about the Richmond Transit Plan, but I have a couple of comments about the regional issues that you're inevitably thinking about. So what's happening in cities, what's happening all over the world is that after a period of time when dense cities seemed to be a thing of the past, everybody wants them again. People of all incomes want to live in dense cities, and I'm going to emphasize people of all incomes need to be able to live in dense cities for dense cities to function. Cities don't have room for everyone to drive. Please always remember when you're talking to your favorite person who's attached to their car that this isn't about your self-esteem, this isn't about your preferences, this isn't about your tastes. This is about space. And there not being much of it in a dense city. The very nature of a city is lots of people in small space, which means not much space per person, which means we have to use space efficiently. And that is the absolute essence of what transit does. If you've seen those famous images of 100 people and how much space they take if they're on a bus, and the same 100 people and how much space they take if they are in cars. By the way, those can be Ubers, those can be Lyfts, those can be electric cars, those can be driverless cars, in which case they'll be a tiny bit closer together, but not nearly as close together as the people are over here. So everything that's coming at us from the tech world, you gotta keep asking, does your big idea solve the space problem? And most of the big ideas I'm hearing about cars do lots of other things, but they don't solve this problem, which is still a big problem. So the other thing to remember is that transit is a win-win. What we know about cars is the more people use cars, the worse they work, right? The more and more people get in cars, they get on the road, you get more and more congestion, the system doesn't work. Transit's exactly the opposite. The more people use transit, the better transit works. And that's why you shouldn't be afraid. One of the things I know you have to do here is combat impressions created by the transit service that you have now, which, you can build on any ridership base. And as your ridership grows, as you incrementally improve service, ridership gets better. There is more support for the service, therefore service gets better still. And that's the path. That's the path to any level of ridership. One of the great things about being from Portland is that I actually moved to Portland in 1969, which means I can remember when famous livable Portland, Oregon looked just about like any other city in the 1960s. And you know, everything that was possible there is possible in your own way for you. Because I can certainly remember a time when the buses were viewed in the way the buses are here, and now, of course, it's completely different. So what's happening in urban transit? A few things, we're going to come back to these. Not just single lines, but total networks. I know you've had great fun having a conversation about a single rapid transit line. And it's time to change the subject to what it means to have a great transit system for the whole city, connecting the whole city. We'll talk about frequent networks. The other thing that's happening is that there's a lot of interesting work going into looking for alternatives for low-demand places where buses are just not a very effective tool. Difficult nooks and crannies. I was looking at a map today, and I was shown a senior housing project in the development in the south side of town that is one long cul-de-sac going back from a busy street and nowhere for a bus to turn around, nowhere for a senior citizen to cross the street. That's a transit-proof place. That place, you know, there's no way to solve that problem with bus service. So, you know, there are going to need to be some other solutions. Vanpool programs are a great thing where lots of people are going to a place that where transit is difficult, like industrial sites or when everyone needs to be there at 1 in the morning. We think there are options where, in certain cases, subsidies to get transit Uber Lyft kinds of taxi Uber Lyft kinds of services. And this is also just an area of tremendous innovation. It's an area to be optimistic about. Let me talk quickly about what's happening in regional transit. Now, right now, you don't have really a complete regional transit system. You have this sort of two-county system, and you have some other things going on, and everything's at the county level. And it's easy to envy a region that has a giant regional transit system where everything is under one roof. MBTA in Boston or something like that. There are some reasons not to envy every aspect of that. So why regional transit matters? Regional transit because there's demand to get to jobs, retail, and activity centers that are not all in Richmond, many of which are not in Richmond. There's also going to be increasing disincentives to driving into Richmond, probably especially to parking in downtown Richmond as more stuff happens here. And finally, this is a very important and very concerning trend that we all worry about, the growing tendency for disadvantaged communities to end up living out in the suburbs. This is a phenomenon called the suburbanization of poverty. It's a very, very dangerous trend because if more and more people who really need transit end up having to live in places where transit is not very workable because of the geography, that's not a problem bus service can solve. Regional transit does not mean one size fits all. And the regional transit systems that were created in the great era of regional transit agency formation, which was kind of the 60s, 70s, and 80s, often ended up with a one-size-fits-all problem. They ended up with an expectation that sort of every jurisdiction inside it would get sort of their population's share of some pie. And one of the reasons that didn't work is that the dense, historic, poor city will always need more transit than the suburbs. It will always need more transit per capita than the suburbs, and you have to figure that out in advance. You have to come up with a regional structure that doesn't try to pretend that all the cities and counties are somehow equivalent and have the same or are the same sort of place. Richmond is just different. And so one of the interesting things that's happening is that core city governments, the historic old city in the center of the region, even if they're in big regional transit agencies, are starting to assert their own role more and more in terms of needing to have a lot of control over their transit and often needing to have more transit than a big regional deal that treated everyone equally would ever give them. If you've been up to DC, you've probably ridden the DC Circulator, which is a great example of a city deciding it just needed something that the regional transit agency was never going to do for it and just doing it themselves, right? But I think there are other examples like Seattle. Seattle is a city that actually is part of a big regional agency but did its own municipal transit plan because it wanted to get it right, and it wanted transit in Seattle to be their policy instead of something the regional transit agency was doing to them or for them. They wanted the politics to be that when they tell their traffic engineer to go, you know, create a transit priority here so the buses can go faster, they want it to be city council telling the traffic engineer to do that, the mayor telling the traffic engineer to do that, rather than some transit agency, right? They wanted there to be that ownership inside the city, and they wanted it to be tied to the city's own goals. And so Seattle's been very effective with that. Their transit system is still run by a regional transit agency, but they've had a lot of influence over its design, and the city of Seattle voters have put their own money into it to give them more service than they could ever get from the region. So now let me step back and talk about what absolutely any transit plan has to work with, which is, I know you all have desires, I know you all have goals, I know you all have visions, I know you all have pet peeves, I know you have all kinds of feelings about what you want and what you're concerned about. But it's going to have to work with the facts of space, the facts of geometry. And part of my goal is it's not going to be like a math class in high school. I'm going to step you through some very simple things, and I want to make them obvious to you. Here's an example of something of a geometric fact, right? An adult elephant will not fit in a wine glass. Right? Now, the reason we get a chuckle about that is that we immediately recognize that as funny because it's actually not a thought you would ever have, because it's an illustration of a more general thing that you all know, whether you know it or not, which is that objects do not fit in containers smaller than themselves. Right? And that's an example of a geometric fact. Even if you've never thought about it, you're absolutely sure about it, aren't you? And that's the beauty of understanding when a fact is geometric. What I'm going to show you is not the result of social science research. It's not the result of any kind of scientific study. A researcher could not even get a grant to actually do the experiment about whether elephants fit in wine glasses. That's how sure we are. We don't need to try it. And that's evidence of the fact that this is something really, really foundational. It's a fact about how space works. And I want you to notice that I'm describing those kinds of facts, and the more you notice when you understand something geometrically, the surer you will be when people start throwing statistics at you. You can attract more writers. This isn't a geometric fact. This is just observing that you have relatively low ridership per unit cost compared to a lot of other cities. That's not geometry. That's empirical. But now let's talk about some geometry. How do we expand? What's the best way to increase ridership? The best way to increase ridership is to increase liberty. The best way to increase ridership is to enable more people to get to more places more quickly so that the service is useful. This is a much ignored point when we're having conversations about exciting technologies or projects or what to build, is that ultimately it's got to be about this. This little diagram, which I want you to take the time to understand, is a diagram I call the wall around your life. So there in the middle, you see a little woman. Her name is Jane. She is every woman, every man. And she's in a particular place. And I've actually plunked her down on a screen, and then I've seen this. This is not Richmond. This is an image from somewhere else. But the point is, that little white area is where she could be in 15 minutes. It's basically the area she could walk to, right? And then the dark blue area is where she could be in 30 minutes. This is on public transit plus walking. So in 30 minutes, you start seeing that she can get out to the east pretty far. And then the pale blue is where she could be in 45 minutes, and then the pink is where she could be in an hour. So I call that the wall around your life because, you know, we think of liberty as being the opposite of imprisonment. But there's a sense in which we're all imprisoned by where we could get. We all have a wall around our lives, which is how far we could go. And where you can go is what you can do. And that's what liberty means, right? The ability to choose to do different things. So, think about everything that's there. We want to talk about access to jobs, but that's just a small part of what this is, right? Yes, you can't hold a job if it's not in that area. Jane can't hold a job if it's not in that area. She can't she can't study if the school isn't in that area. But it's also, you know, if she's not going to meet Mr. Wright if Mr. Wright doesn't live in that area. Right? Everything about our choices, everything about the opportunities that our lives present us with, online dating aside, work from home aside, we've seen the limits, we've all experienced the limits of that. Sooner or later, you've got to get your body in presence of whatever this thing is, and that requires the ability to get there. And that means the wall around your life matters. So, what does a high ridership transit network do? It moves the walls further out. It enables you to get to more places so you can do more things. How do we do that? I'll come back to this. I'll talk through it. Well, no, actually, just quickly, it has to do with frequency. It has to do with a connected network. And it has to do with focusing the best service on the transit-friendly places. That's the tough part. But let me just talk you through the geometry. So here's the cool thing about frequency, which is how often a vehicle comes along a route. This is geometry, which I'm as sure of this as I am about elephants and wine glasses. So frequency does three cool things when you have buses coming more frequently, or trains, or whatever. First of all, it means the wait is shorter, which means you go when you want to go. right? You get there when you want to get there. Second, it's easy to connect from one line to another. Now, in transit maps, you'll often see lots of routes going around and crossing each other, but those are mostly like two roads crossing each other without an interchange, right? Because if the lines aren't frequent, that connecting bus isn't coming anytime soon. It's not really useful. Here's what's useful. When you have a line with buses coming frequently and another line with buses coming frequently, then this is almost like you're in a car and you can either go straight or you can turn, because the transfer is so easy because the bus is coming, right? That's the very essence of how high frequency creates networks. That's the structure by which we put a network together. So the people, and that's what expands people's liberty so much. And yes, frequency is also less risk of disruption. This is why frequency pays off so much. That's just a pile of bus routes in lots of different cities we've worked in. We keep piling it in a database. Higher frequency is to the left. Higher productivity, riders divided by the cost of providing service, goes up. It's not just an obvious relationship, but it's actually a little curved. You see those extraordinary payoffs that happen on the far left when we get down to 10 or 15 minute frequencies. That seems to be a magic threshold when all of these things, well, it's not magic, it's geometry. But it is the point where a lot of these things start to take off. But here's the thing. I have been saying this for 20 years, and over time I've realized I've got to stop and think about why so few people get this. And I think it has to do with the fact that most people are motorists. And most of the influential people we're trying to convince are themselves motorists. And many of you are motorists, and you know, I love motorists. There are lots of motorists. Motorists are great people. There's nothing wrong with you for driving a car, especially given your options in many places. But if you drive a car all the time, you are having an experience of speed, you're having an experience of reliability, but you're not having an experience of frequency. You're not having an experience of, I can't go until, which is what frequency is, right? The closest thing you have to that is traffic signals. And that's, you know, that's 2 minutes. That's nothing like what it is like to be on an hourly bus route, right? So finally, I've learned I have to say things like, okay, I know you live in the suburbs, drive a car, good for you. Imagine there's a gate at the end of your driveway and it only opens every hour on the hour. Only every hour on the hour can you get your car out. If you imagine that situation, then suddenly getting this gate to open more often would be a lot more important than like making the roads go faster, right? And that's exactly how it works in transit. It's great that the BRT is going to be a little bit faster. Speed is important, but frequency is overwhelming because wait time is so often bigger than travel time, unless we design it right. That's why there are a lot of frequent network brands now. A lot of cities are actually promoting their frequent networks and talking about them as an ideal thing with slogans like turn up and go, or my own contribution, frequency is freedom. Frequency is also tied to affordability in an interesting way. And I mean particularly now frequent bus service. One of the things we all know when we build streetcars or light rail lines is that the land value around the stations immediately goes way up. And we have trouble then creating affordable housing there, or making those to be places where people can still afford to live. Frequent bus service doesn't have that problem. We can lay out a large enough frequent bus network that it can get to lots of people, and it can be abundant enough that although it doesn't go everywhere, it goes enough places that it can't possibly drive up real estate prices everywhere it goes. What that means, and yet frequent service is so useful that you can encourage affordable housing there. One very important thing a city can do is require less parking when you're on a high frequency route, because that means fewer people will drive, more people will take the bus. That means you need less parking. One of the most infuriating things for a low income person looking for housing is not having a car and not being able to get an apartment that doesn't come with a parking space, right? Because you're paying for that parking space that you're not going to use. If it's underground, you can't even do a container garden if there isn't enough light. You know, what do you do with that? So there should be less parking where there's more transit, because there are going to be more people without cars who are trying to do that service. So now there's also, you know, that's the nice part, the service. So let me talk about the tough part, which is that frequent service is expensive, and so we have to focus on places where more people are going to benefit from. And this is where this gets a little, we have to be careful. But let me take you through this carefully. When we talk about a favorable environment for transit, I am talking only about the physical layout of the neighborhood. I'm talking about how the street pattern runs. I'm talking about the density. I'm talking about how easy it is to walk. I'm not talking about who lives there. That's very important. I'm just talking about the sheer geometry of the layout of a neighborhood. So here's where it comes down to. Where density is high. So here's two routes that have the same cost. They both have two buses on them. But in the top image, there are twice as many houses around it, around the route. So twice as many people live near that route as live near that one. Of course, the ridership's going to be at least twice as high where there are twice as many people. So of course, high-frequency service is going to be more likely to want to run through this neighborhood than through this neighborhood, because the service is going to cost the same, but here we get twice as many people. Walkability, it matters enormously whether your local street network looks like this, in which case it's very easy to walk to a stop, wherever it is, or it looks like this, in which case fewer people can walk to the stop, which brings our ridership potential down. It's very important whether you can cross the street at a stop. When you get out onto your some of your fast boulevards out of the south side, or certainly once you get outside of Richmond, you find this problem all the time. If it is not safe to cross the street, then when you put a stop on one side of the street, you are providing one-way service, right? Because there's no way to get to the stop on the other side of the street for going the other way. These are the fundamentals. Linearity. Now, architects, all of our architects and designers and urbanists know about density and walkability, which is great. Linearity is peculiar to transit, and they often aren't as careful with it. Again, here's a city with four kinds of development, right? Four developments. Here is the same city with the same development, but in a different arrangement, where the developments are all back on their own cul-de-sacs, right? They're exactly the same development pattern, the same density, the same walkability, but the linearity makes a huge difference, because here, all the I can provide straight direct service between any two of them. Here, if I want to run a route from here to here, it goes through these, and by the time you get over here, nobody from here wants to be riding. Right? So linearity is the crucial thing. And the fourth thing is proximity. All of the things being equal, it's going to be faster and more cost-effective to take people shorter distances than longer ones. This is going to be one of the fundamental geometrical challenges of your regional transit planning, because it matters how far away things are. And, you know, a town that is 5 miles outside of Richmond is going to look at a town that are 20 miles outside of Richmond could be identical in every way, but the town 20 miles away is going to support less service because it costs so much more to get there, and it's not because we don't like those people. Again, it's not about who, it's just about geometry. So here's the most challenging part of what I have to say, which is that the high ridership, high liberty approach that maximizes liberty for most people isn't ideal for absolutely everyone. But we do our best. So, as I said, if I'm really trying to maximize liberty and therefore maximize ridership, I want to run the high frequency. And to run high frequency, I have to run the fewest lines that I can so that I can afford to run them frequently. You can't get around that, right? If I have fewer lines, I can put more buses on them. If I have more lines, I have to spread the buses over them. If I have two lines, there can be a bus always coming soon. But in this little town, if I have two lines, there can be a bus always coming soon. But if I have to have 10 lines, each of these buses is coming once an hour. Right? Can't get around it. So these are these kind of competing goals that we have to think about. When I'm really planning for maximum liberty and maximum ridership, I'm doing a few things. One of the things is I'm tolerating longer walks, because one of the basic ways that this works is that somebody who lives over here doesn't have a bus stop in front of their house, but it's worth it to walk over here because then the service is really good. This tends to support dense and walkable development because that's where this wants to go. This is how you get maximum competition with cars. All the environmental benefits of transit arise from people riding transit, not from transit existing. So you have to be, no, that's an important point. You have to be pursuing a ridership. Now, I'll tell you how this comes up. Somebody representing a business park on a long cul-de-sac out in the suburbs, carved out of a forest, everything wrong. No density, no walkability, no linearity. no proximity, it's way out there, comes to us and says, but we're trying to meet environmental goals and save the planet from climate change, and we can't do that without transit service. And the answer may be, transit service out to you would be so expensive and carry so few people that it is not actually helping the planet at all, right? It may be helping you, which is fine, that's the coverage goal, but be realistic about this. If you're going to maximize ridership, maximize liberty for the most people, not everybody is going to be on a frequent route. But the coverage goal also has an important history. This is the history of meeting everyone's requests. This is the history of how transit aid networks develop, when the way they develop is that somebody calls and asks for a bus to go over here, and the city council, they call their city councilor, and the city councilor calls the transit agency and says, you should run a bus over there. Your own system, your own network has gotten the way it is partly because of that. Everyone's hands. And so that tends to move us in the direction of lots more little routes, and therefore lower frequency, and therefore ultimately less useful service. But there are very important reasons we do this. One is lifeline access. One is our concern for disadvantaged people who may be marooned in hard to reach places. So I'm not saying that one of these is necessarily more important than the other. I am saying that they're geometrically different and opposite, and we have to be able to think clearly about how much of each one we want. Because the more of one you have, the less you're going to have of the other. So, you know, what I generally try to do with transit agencies, we've had that conversation here in Richmond to a degree, is say, okay, the ridership liberty goal is important, the coverage goal is important. Where do you want to be? Where do you want to come down on that spectrum? So I'll give you an example of how it worked in Houston, which is one of the bigger redesigns I've done. The existing system was 50-50, only about, you know, they wondered why their ridership was going down, and the answer was that only about half of their service was in a place where you could expect ridership. The other half was doing coverage. It was doing things that we know will never carry many people because of where they are. So the existing system was about half and half. The board wanted ridership to be higher. I took them through a process of saying, where do you want it to be? I never told them. And they said they wanted it to be 80% ridership, 20% coverage. And what we felt we could do there was abandon almost nobody, although we would definitely be asking many people to walk further in order to build a more frequent network. I'll show it to you in a second. So longer walks for many, but almost nobody without service. Now at this point, I need you to remember these four colors because I'll use them in several maps. In all of our maps, you're going to see the black is the rapid. I'm going to show you maps of Richmond too. The black is the rapid. The red is frequent local bus, but every 15 minutes or less, always coming pretty soon. That's the red network. That's what we collectively call the frequent network. Then there are half-hourly bus routes, which are blue, and hourly bus routes, which are green. Hourly service is really useless to most people. In fact, it has the unique ability to get dreadful ridership out of absolutely any landing stand. That's been my experience. I've seen hourly routes that run down major streets lined with towers and nobody's on them either. Or, I mean, it's not that nobody's on them, it's even worse. There are four people on them who really need it. But it's never going to grow very much because it's just so not very useful. So Houston, this is what the network used to look like. You can see the whole extent of blue and green lines spreading out. It's an enormous city. But then you can also see that the red lines, the frequent network, it all went downtown. In fact, it's worse than that. It all went to the downtown that was downtown 40 years ago. If you followed the history of Houston, you know that now Houston is a great region. And if you look out over Houston from a tall building, you will see clusters of skyscrapers all over the region. There are many downtowns now. None of that was reflected here. We had to break out of this and into a more everywhere-to-everywhere network. But we also just needed a whole bunch more frequent service. So we did not add any operating cost. We did not increase the budget. We did not increase the revenue from taxpayers. And we changed it from this to this. Before, after. How did we find all of that service? Well, part of it was just inefficiencies in the existing network. Part of it was also that we very carefully moved lines further apart. When we built a red line, we had to take out the blue line that was, you know, a quarter mile away from it. And we'll talk more about why. But we were able to build all this connective high-frequency service, and it just takes people so many more places. So again, you know, newly connecting a million people to a million jobs with frequent service, this was a lot of how we won the argument. But fundamentally, more frequency but on fewer routes. The number of routes goes down, the amount of squiggling goes down. And here's the sort of motto that I want you to remember. Walk further, wait less, get there sooner. Because that's how the geometry works. If you walk further, you'll wait less, and therefore you'll get there sooner. So, are you willing to do that? Let's look at it in Richmond. Let's come home and look at what this means here. So, we've done a series of different conceptual networks for how the city network might look under different circumstances. This one's called the familiar because it's basically the transit system you know, cleaned up a little bit with the BRT laid in. So there's your BRT line, but other than that, it looks pretty familiar. That's why we call it the familiar network, because it's not much change. Here's the opposite extreme. This is the furthest push toward a ridership network, which I want to also call a liberty network. It is a network of very high frequency lines, which are therefore worth walking to. Let me just give you an example. Right up here in the north, you may be familiar with Chamberlain, and right next to it, four blocks away, is Brook. In the familiar scenario, there is actually a little line running down that dotted line running down that part of Brook. In the future scenario, that little dotted line is gone. And that's because you are four blocks from a high frequency route. As a matter of fact, if you live on a, let's talk about Monument. So if you live on Monument, the issue is even right now, if you're going downtown and you're on Monument and you're actually in a hurry, the odds are that your hourly bus is not there when you need it, they usually aren't. The fast thing to do is to ignore your hourly bus route and just walk over to Broad Street where the bus is coming soon. And that's what people do, and that's why it doesn't make sense to keep the little green line close to the frequent line. And we know people are going to be angry about this. I want to be very clear. When we make this kind of move, I do not tell city council, I do not tell transit boards, yeah, this will be fine. No. What I told the Houston Transit Board was, you are going to sit through some brutal public hearings. Because people are going to be angry at you about this change, and they're going to come and tell you why. And you're going to need to decide whether you're willing to sit through that. Because always we get negative feedback. We get negative feedback from proposing anything. In fact, the feedback we got from Houston when people actually went and tabulated it, somebody finally pointed out that the basic theme of all the negative feedback on the Houston plan was, your service is terrible, don't change anything. So when your organization is figuring out how to comment on our transit plan, please check what your organization is saying and make sure it doesn't boil down to that. Your service is terrible, don't change anything. So here's why you might want to change everything. That's a big change. A whole lot of routes have disappeared in order to create that frequent network, but here's why you might want to do it. Remember Jane? Remember Jane in her bubbles? Let's look at how this affects her. VCU. With the familiar network. There she is at VCU. Look where she can get to in an hour, even. She can barely get to the south side. She can get, she can get pretty a little ways out to the edge of Henrico, but she can't get to Richmond University. She can't get to lots of places. Look at the south side. And then there's where she could get to. Okay? Before, after, before, after. Walk further, wait less, get further soon. Now, how can you tell Jane that she shouldn't have this? How can you tell Jane that she shouldn't be able to get to all these places? Or that people living in all of these places should be able to commute to VCU, whichever direction the trip is, right? East End. We just dropped Jane. Sort of arbitrary point in the East End, it's up on Whitcomb. There's where she can get to today. And then this is really, really, really a serious problem in the East End. The transit system doesn't work very well. It's partly because it's not very frequent. It's also because of the way transfers are forced downtown. So by the time she's waited for a bus, gotten downtown, had to wait for another infrequent bus, the only thing she can get to even in an hour is a stretch of Broad Street.
can't get anywhere else. I completely understand why people in East Hampton are not happy with their transit service. Here's where she can go instead.
Okay.
Before, after. With a network that's more oriented toward frequency. Carytown today, Carytown under a ridership approach. Southside Plaza today, look at that again. Southside, very difficult area. But again, frequencies are so low that by the time buses actually come, most of her travel time budget is gone. That's why you mostly just see walk radius around her, right? The what looks like a pink circle around her is just where she could walk it at, right? It's only when you see bulges coming out of the circle that she's actually on the bus at all, right? That's what's going on here, right? You see that? You can see those circles around her. That's just the walk radius. But if she goes further, that's when the bus system is relevant. So here in Southside Plaza today, and then what?
Oh, wow.
So this is why you might want to come to a public hearing where people are yelling at your board about this and tell them that there's actually a reason to go ahead and do this, despite that people are yelling. This is the reason why your organization that you represent might want to look at this, look at the reports that are going to come out, think about what's actually better for the whole city, and think about what position you want to take. Because many people will be angry. And people are always angry, and that's it. That's what it is. So I want to wrap up now in a few minutes with some big themes. In case you haven't noticed, there's a lot of concern about America becoming a more polarized society. And to me, polarization is not just kind of, you know, Democrats and Republicans going at each other. Polarization is the fact that it is easier and easier for us to spend all of our time around people who think exactly the way we do.
Right.
That's kind of what Facebook is, isn't it? Right? Facebook is, you've tended to declare, to say that your friends, you know, you add people as friends because they say things that you like, and before you know it, you get on Facebook and it seems like the whole world agrees with you. You know, that's our way of just staying in our own little bubble, even if it's a bubble spread all over the world. So I want to start by blowing up one of the most destructive polarizations that people bring to this topic, which is the notion that there is something called a choice right. So in the story that we're told, and a lot of professionals still tell this story, and I want to give you the tools to talk back to them if they do. In the way this works, there's a guy who likes his car and he drives his car everywhere, he loves his car, and I'm supposed to make him leave his car in the driveway. Once when I was presenting a transit plan that I'd done for an agency in suburban Southern California, a board member who represented the wealthiest city there leaned forward and said, "Now, Mr. Walker, if we adopt this plan of yours, will that make me leave my BMW in the driveway?" I'm not sure what I said, but what I thought was, no, sir, if you have a BMW, if you're fortunate enough to have a BMW, and if your BMW is so important to you that you needed us all to know this right now, then no, you're going to drive. But you know what? You're a city councilor in the wealthiest city in this district. I'm sure you've earned everything you have. Congratulations on your success, but there aren't very many of you. When you have a chance, perhaps some of you are in this case, but when you have a chance to talk to millionaires or especially billionaires or people in elite positions in the society, and they start going on about what they would like personally, you have to very gently say, "Congratulations, sir, you're part of an elite. But that means there aren't very many of you, and because there aren't very many of you, it would be stupid to design the transit system around your tastes." Right? That's math. That's math there. Okay? And I see that mistake made all the time. Toronto recently had designed an airport rail line, or rather, a bunch of extremely elite people in Toronto designed an airport rail line based on what they thought they would ride, and it was a complete fiasco.
and had to be completely redone a year later when they discovered that there were not enough billionaire bankers to actually fill trains every 15 minutes from Toronto Airport, and they had designed something that was too expensive and didn't stop in the right places for anywhere but billionaire bankers to use it. Sure enough, failure. So, we're helping the elites out by reminding them that there aren't really enough of them for us to focus on their tastes. But at the opposite extreme, the other problem with the choice rider is that it conveys this opposite of a dependent rider, someone that we imagine has to use transit, is stuck with transit. And when a certain transportation professionals get together in small rooms and they think nobody else is listening, they use an even worse word. They call these people captives. Captive riders like we have them in the dungeon. This is not how it works. I have, and this is an interesting for those of you who work in the low-income and minority communities, and you're working with people who have this sort of relationship to transit, but they don't have a lot of alternatives. And you're tempted to come in and say, we are dependent on this service. But you may want to stop and think about whether you're transit dependent or transit empowered. Because when you say you're dependent, a large part of the audience thinks, well, we don't want to, you know, doesn't, looks down on you, and looks down on you for being dependent. But if you're transit empowered, and if too, the reality is transit can get bad enough for you to not use it. Transit can get bad enough that you will figure out some other way. Or in the worst case, transit will get bad enough that you can't keep your job over there, which also causes you to disappear from the system. So this notion that we have a bedrock of riders that were stuck with us and whose views we don't need to care about because they're stuck with us, that's what that does, right? And likewise, the choice rider is also an illusion because the reality is that we're all in the middle, and it's a spectrum. And there are people everywhere along the spectrum. People are in all different situations. They have different choices. They've set up a classic example of a person right in the middle of the spectrum is a couple who've chosen to share one car, maybe so that they can live in a denser place. And so they have a car option sometimes, but not always. And so they're sort of choice and sort of captive, aren't they? Or all of the young millennials, many of them quite fortunate, many of them quite well off financially, who choose to live in a place where they won't need a car. Are they choice or captive? And just all of our completely different situations, which lay us out on a whole spectrum of possibilities. And it's only if you visualize that spectrum that we explain what actually happens, which is when we make a small incremental improvement in transit, we get a ridership payoff. And when we cut transit, we get a ridership loss. That wouldn't happen if everybody were in choice. And that's why you have to resist the message that the only thing that matters in transit is coming up with something brand new that will attract that choice rider. There aren't that many of them. And the key is actually to design the kind of network that a diversity of people will choose to use. So who are these people? What do I feel when I drive down a road and I see, waiting next to a ditch, a 60-year-old woman with a bag of groceries in a situation that I would not be willing to wait in, but also in a situation that I empathize with? Think of all the emotions that are ready to come up there. I could be, I could look down on her, loser, you know? I could empathize with her, I could pity her. There's actually another view that I have of her when I see her, of people in that situation. For whatever reason, she's using transit before it's good enough for a lot of people to use transit. She also knows it really well from the inside. Well, in Silicon Valley, that would be called an early adopter. Another word for an early adopter is pioneer. A pioneer or early adopter is somebody who tries it out while it's still not all that good. And it's only because they do that it has a chance to get better. And that's what I want you to think of and visualize next time you see someone who's waiting for a bus in a situation where you might not be willing to. And I encourage those of you who are in that situation or who represent people who are in that situation to think about talking about them in ways that really capture why all of us should be grateful to you, just as we're grateful to Pioneer. So fundamentally, to wrap it up, transit thrives on diversity. And this is the challenge. The more people ride, the more everyone benefits.
High ridership is diverse ridership. That's why transit can't be only for people like you. Because if you've ridden the most successful transit systems in the world, something like the New York City subway, if you've ever ridden it, you'll notice the diversity. A billionaire is sitting next to the guy who washes dishes in his favorite restaurant, and that's why this thing is so spectacularly successful. So we must always resist the temptation to want transit just for us, just for our people, just for my Facebook feed, just for my neighborhood. Because it's also not like libraries, and this is something I always have to explain to elected officials who are used to having conversations about libraries. The conversation in a city council about libraries is, your district got the new library, and now it's my turn, and my district gets one. Because a library is a sort of thing for the neighborhood, it benefits the neighborhood. That is not how transit works. Your route in your neighborhood is only useful if it's part of a network that takes you out across to all these other neighborhoods, right? It's you can have a little, every time somebody tries to draw a circulated route that goes around in their own neighborhood like this, people try to do this, they don't work very well. Because that's not what great transit is. Great transit is getting you out across the city to lots of places. So remember, your service in your neighborhood is also theirs, and theirs is also yours, and you just can't chop it apart. And you know, to wrap it up, we're trained so much to think in win-lose terms, aren't we? That winning means somebody losing. Sports, elections, wars, you don't know you've won unless somebody lost. So the winner is actually dependent on the loser, isn't it? Because if you don't have losers there, you don't know you won. And that's just not how transit works. Transit is a win-win. You start out with a space-efficient vehicle that leaves more room in the city for everybody because you need less space for cars. But it's not just the vehicle. Lots of esteemed architects think that transit's just about finding a cool vehicle. No, it's about creating an efficient, liberating network that goes all over the city, that's useful to lots of people. And it's not for the sake of the network, it's for the sake of your liberty and opportunity. Mm-hmm. It's for the sake of moving outward the wall around your life so that you can go to more places and therefore do more things. That's what it's about. Thank you.
Thank you, Jarrett. That was great. We do have time for questions. I would ask you that you would stand up and speak loudly, and Jarrett, if you wouldn't mind, just sort of restating the question when it's asked so that we can get it for the video.
Questions?
Right here.
First is always the hardest.
Good evening, my name is Scott Berger. I've been taking part in a lot of these transit conversations, and I'm certainly for better mass transit in Richmond, and I'm certainly for more concentration on ridership within the Richmond transportation, mass transit. However, before voting for that, I'll make this comment. GRTC does a good job of coverage within its budget. The reason why I say that is because GRTC gets most of its funding from the City of Richmond via City Council vote every single year. There's no dedicated funding. And so, I'm certainly for, like I said, better mass transit. However, realize that I think in order to do so in a meaningful way, we need to get to a different model with GRTC getting dedicated funding. Not relying on a city council vote every single year. That may mean foregoing art centers, baseball stadiums, coliseums, the latest shiny toy. And I'd like to hear what your thoughts are on budgeting for better mass transit.
You are going to need more money sooner or later. I think the map that's going to come out soon with the Richmond network that is proposed for October 2017 when BRT opens. Let me be very clear, it's going to contain disappointments. We've already worked on it enough to know that we're disappointed. So just know the people who drew this are disappointed too because the money only goes so far. It's much better than the existing, as I showed you, it's going to be a vast improvement on the existing system for most people in terms of where they can get to, but it's not everything. So We won't, and yes, the next step will be that. My only caution when we go to the region is you don't have to pass a regional funding source and win in all the counties the same way. You can also piece it together, because sometimes it's likely to be the case here that Richmond itself needs more, and that the people in Richmond may be willing to pay more than everyone across the entire region. And a sensible way of organizing this treats that as a feature rather than a bug, and creates the structure that allows, as has happened in Seattle, you know, after Seattle was frustrated for years by never being given a transit by this kind of agency that was dominated by the suburbs. You know, now Seattle has its own thing, has its own funding source, and therefore, you know, has the level of service it needs. So that's what makes me cautious.
But the transit network plan that you're proposing will not call for increased funding, correct?
It is a rearrangement of the service that is there now. That is why it will be disappointing. Sir?
How does a transit agency interact with the city? I buy the notion of walk more, wait less, and ride faster, but if I encounter in that additional walk, you know, a bad, you know, no sidewalks or poor lighting, how does that in the transit organization's responsibility, but if you want me to walk further, fortunately here, winter not that bad, summers can be a bit oppressive, so how does that piece of work?
How do you do that? That is one of the great things that happens when cities start deciding that transit is important to them. Here's the key, and it's happening now in Richmond. The fact that this plan is being done is evidence of this. And in the work, I'll tell you, the workshops that we've done with the professional staff to try to sort of hammer out the ideas, you've had the Richmond Planning Department represented, you've had the Richmond Traffic Commission represented. They've been there, it's been worth their time to sit through these day-long workshops, much of which are not interesting to them, so that they can be thinking as we go about how this relates to their work. Those two functions in particular, land use and, you know, traffic and public works, that is creating the transit reality. And, you know, I like to say too, transit ridership is not mostly just the result of the network, it's the result of how the network interfaces with the land use planning and the street design, the built environment, right? And so the city already controls the majority of that. So I think that's why I think that, you know, one of the great things that happens when cities choose to lead, even within the context of wanting a regional solution in those areas of congregation, when a city chooses to lead, you get the opportunity for what we're having now, which is the planning department, the traffic folks in particular, really being encouraged to think about this frequent network and how, as we draw this frequent network, it changes their reality in certain ways. Because the frequent network is big enough that it's going to carry enough people that it has a greater entitlement to protection from traffic congestion because it's so many people, right, and so much service. And more people are going to walk to it, so the sidewalk issues are more important, the street kind of, the crosswalks are often the biggest problem. So it all starts to come together, but it comes together only because, and you're fortunate in Richmond, it's already happening, the key city people who control these adjacent but critical roles are interested and are at the table. And where that will go, one hopes, is a more kind of recursive process where when you do a master land use plan, you've got the transit planners at the table and you're looking at the most recent versions of the transit map. So you're always kind of iterating together. You know, I like, even if you can't all be in the same process, which sometimes just gets unwieldy, you can at least toss the ball back and forth, you know? So we're doing a frequent network plan, we're tossing that over to planning, we're gonna encourage them to look at those frequent routes and see about how that might affect. Like, oh, we got a frequent route, maybe we can require less parking. Or maybe we should prioritize this site. And, you know, then they come up with a master traffic plan or land use plan and the back, oh, okay, so there's an opportunity for transit there. You know, so you just keep doing it. You just keep going back and forth. Sir.
Yes, I'm Charles Rondo. I live in Chesterfield, which is one of the transit deserts. And strangely enough, Chesterfield owns half of GRTC. And it uses that power to prevent buses from coming into that county. And I read your very excellent choices report, and in there you allude to the effect of discrimination and all the Jim Crow stuff, which has affected this area. And that's one factor out in Chesterfield and elsewhere. However, Chesterfield also seems to be developing itself in a way which is totally antithetical to any kind of transit. And cul-de-sacs everywhere, they just mushroom. And the Hell Street and the Lothian Turnpike, which, as you observe, are antithetical to transit. So how are we going to do that?
Well, here's the challenge in a regional context. And you know, we've got to kind of separate our situation today from all of our feelings about centuries of history, you know, centuries of death and importance. The reality right now is the way you put a regional transit agency together is among the people who want to be part of it. And if someone doesn't want to be part of it, because you see, if you go in and say, we need a regional transit agency that involves all of these counties, you've given every county a veto now. So you actually have to say, we want to come up with something so cool that every county wants to be part of it. You don't want to be part of it? Fine. We'll start with that and we'll see what you feel like in a few years of us without us having a great transit system. Right? That's often how it works. You know, remember the parable of Georgetown, right? Georgetown in Washington, D.C. is not on the D.C. Metro line because they were too snooty at the time and didn't want those people in their neighborhood. And now, you know, they've been regretting that for decades. Fortunately, with buses, you know, it's not such a permanent mistake. So I think that's the answer. You have to be able to move forward with a regional vision, but you've also got to have the opt-outs, because you don't have, if people don't want it or have it forced on them, you know, then you're giving them a veto. Sir, the gentleman with the cane.
I also live in Chesterfield, so thank you for saying something about that. I was wondering, I think great plan. I'm really excited. Ride the bus pretty frequently. And obviously I need to ride the bus a lot of times. But I guess I'm asking, so I'd love to get your thoughts on accessibility. And I know that's not a part of the, I know that's not something you touched on, but like as of right now, the buses that JRTC has, I would say maybe a third of them announce the stops. And then, you know, I have my fare ticket, which has a printed amount on it, but I can't see it.
Right.
So I've got to ask for all kinds of help when I get on the bus. And, you know, how does that look for somebody, you know, with multiple disabilities? I would love to get your thoughts on how other cities have done that, kind of bridge that gap.
The large issue of accommodating disabilities and accommodating the huge diversity of disabilities, you know, sight impairment, hearing impairment, all kinds of physical impairment, all kinds of invisible disabilities, you know, which many of us have, and just differences in our bodies that make different things work. This is again something where the history is terrible, and we are of course, you know, working from a base, from, you know, an infrastructure created at a time when nobody cared about this. Now, at least we care about this, and people do care about this, and, you know, we have the Americans with Disabilities Act, and we have a lot of requirements that make sure that over time, as things get developed and improved, services for the disabled improve. I think I would generally say that if you get into bigger and bigger transit cities, if you get into bigger transit systems, you'll encounter a lot more people whose job it is to watch out for that, and you'll see the difference. GRTC is still a pretty small system. But I'm very optimistic about it. I think that people who are living with any sort of disability, you know, you have to make your own choices about the reality of where you are and, you know, what's going to happen again. You know,
in a time scale that matters for you, you know, as opposed to the time scale in which massive infrastructure gets fixed. You pointed out some simple things like stop announcements, which I think are low-hanging fruit that you should be able to make. But obviously, so much of the disability challenge is various kinds of infrastructure, and that's, of course, a longer journey than the first. Thank you for that question. Sir, here we go.
My name is Tim Parker. Thank you for coming today. I am what your presentation would have been called a choice writer. I have a good job, I could buy a car, I choose not to. People call me a hipster at work, and that's who I am. This is how people view me. A lot of people think that all people my age who look like me are like that as well. And in Richmond, it's just not true. This idea of a millennial all wanting to use transit.
No, but I'll stand over here and turn face to the room. I'll stand here and also.
Because I am like, I'm talking to everybody in general. A lot of people aren't, well, most young people in this city, they don't use transit. That comes because of the view of Richmond's transit, which obviously we're here to totally change. But what do I say to my friends who, oh, why do you do that? Why don't you just buy a car?
Why do you do that?
Well, I've been from being 2 miles from work, so.
Okay, there you go. So, let's start this whole business about judging each other for our own choices. You know, let's start with the fact that we've each made our choices in the context of our specific geographical situation, right? If you live really close to work, you know, then you solve one of the big transportation problems of daily life without needing a car. And then right away, of course, it starts to make sense, especially now that we've got some backup systems like Uber and Lyft and taxis for when transit isn't there. You can start to do that and start to make sense. You can even start to pencil out compared to coming in front. But that works in your geographical situation.
Sure.
So one of the things I want to encourage everyone to do is to stop thinking about people's mode choices as a cultural decision. Because it's everybody's making their choice about whether to own a car, how much to use a transit, in the context of where they live, where they need to go, what their family situation is. And so when I hear that, you know, only these kinds of people are using transit, only this number of people are using transit, and I look at the transit system and I look at the blobs of freedom that are created, sort of blobs of imprisonment, right? I don't need any more explanation for why more people aren't using transit. It's not that useful to that many people. And so if it's logical that they're not using transit, then I don't need a cultural explanation. See what I mean? The geometry explains it, so I don't need a cultural explanation. So, and what that means to me is when people start telling you about, you know, well, how do we get a different clientele on the transit, you know, as though, you know, painting the bus a different color or getting Wi-Fi or something. No, make it useful. You just need, you happen to be in a situation where it works for you. Most people aren't using it because they're not in a situation where it works for them. Put more people in a situation where it works for them. That's what we're doing.
Sure.
That's really all it is. And so it doesn't have to be a cultural generalization. It doesn't have to be that. Sir, in the back, I think you were next to the point.
You mentioned the suburbanization of poverty. And I lived in D.C. for 6 years, used a lot of transit up there, really enjoyed it. But I also noticed that, like, you know, we've got the Orange Line corridor, very hot, very wealthy now, like everything kind of came in, property prices are very high. I mean, how do you, if we have the transit system that we dream of in Richmond, how does it now turn into something where it's all high property values, people who need it most are on the fringes? How do you combat that potential?
So I think you are fortunate that you are seeing this problem in other cities early enough to learn from. The question is, how, as we develop a transit system, do we not have it, you know, drive up property values to the point that we force, you know, people who can't afford those property values to live in Chesterfield where there's no transit, right? Or to live somewhere else where, you know, transit is not. And then they are all buy cars, and that makes them poor, right? That's how that works. So, how we do that is to notice the problem and talk about it before it's a crisis. I come from a wealthy, successful city on the West Coast. It is a crisis. Every mayoral election is about, this is about affordability and homelessness. It is almost all we talk about. That's how bad it is.
We just had a mayoral election that was like 90%. So the way you get onto it early is to be thinking about, first of all, you know, not falling in love with a giant library system, right? You know, and do it incrementally. Respect the frequent bus. Make sure, focus on getting a frequent bus network that's extensive enough that it can go to enough places that it can't possibly raise property values in all of them, right? That's the real key to how that drives affordability. Work on parking minimums. The single city policy that does most to undermine transit, that is under direct control, are requirements of developers to add lots of parking. And particularly destructive are the requirements of apartment developments to add parking. If the goal is for them to be affordable, the way you get an affordable apartment is to put it on a frequent transit route. Because there are so many of them that you can find a space where it's not expensive. Put it on a frequent transit route and don't give it a parking space per adult. Right. Because parking is huge. Parking is one of the main reasons that apartment buildings can't be built. So there are things you can do. And you can learn from cities that where this is a crisis, like Portland or Ireland, and intervene soon enough. So we're on 7:30, is that our, should we?
We've got a couple more minutes.
You got a couple more minutes, okay. Let me see.
Cost savings working with school systems. High schoolers are the American people I'm talking about.
So have we had success working with school systems? School systems, high schools, and you know, secondary schools and so on can are a source of ridership around the edges, but not when 300 kids show up at the bus stop all at once. Which, so there's the issue of the bell time and the tendency, especially in a large high school, to create a single instantaneous demand that a bus system has a lot of trouble. So I was in California during the period when they cut all of their yellow buses all over the state, including out in suburban areas, where there was like no reason to run bus service except that some had over 500 kids on the corner at 315. And that was actually a huge burden on the transit agency because they had to buy all of these buses to run once to drain 500 kids away from this bus. So that's the downside of schools, which is the peak demand, especially for a suburban high school, which is no reason to bus, is a problem for transit. The urban high school, yes, but of course the urban high school has all sorts of other solutions too, because things are walking distance. You know, it's easier to buy buses and so on. It is a challenge in that suburban language there. It still is. Please think about this the next time you locate a high school or secondary school. Because a lot of them are hard to get to places. And Shelby, you want to answer that?
This woman had a question, but maybe it was answered by somebody else.
Okay. Hands up. Next question. Sir, in the back.
I've had one time that it's important to have, and I'm asking you whether this is important, but clear windows on buses so you can see people and they sort of feel like an extension of people walking. GRTC doesn't have that. We have giant ads on the bus. Is that important? Should we change it?
Okay, bus advertising is what we call a Faustian bargain, and sometimes you can name bus advertising. Advertising on the exterior of buses that makes it hard to see those. Right?
Yeah.
I'm not going to second guess any transit agency's financial situation, what they're getting from that, and what service they would have to cut if they didn't have that revenue. But in general, I agree with you. I think that buses are more attractive if we can see into them before we board them. Why did we invent the glass wall conference room? Right? It's because we don't want to barge in without kind of seeing what's going on in there, right? Or maybe someone in there we don't want to be in the room. So it's the same sort of thing. Walking into any room, when you get on a bus, you're walking into a wrench. And I think that ability to see it, also the ability to see out. You know, I even look at the spire of the buses that we can largely see through. And I'm starting to see those in Europe. So I don't like anything on the windows. And I'm not going to second guess transit agencies who feel like they have that choice. Sir Boucher.
Brady Harper, VCU. We had a good question asked about Chesterfield, but I also wanted to ask about Henrico. In your dealings with, I assume and hope that you've spoken with some of the members of leadership at Henrico, I'm curious because it seems that the next logical step for the BRT is either to the east going to the airport and or to the west going out to Short Pump. What has been your interaction with Henrico, and do they seem interested? Does it seem like that's a logical next step and something that's going to happen?
Henrico and Vertigo with Henrico and these spheres to come. I have, it is not our job to have a lot of conversations with Henrico. We're working on the Richmond plan, but lots of conversations with Henrico are happening at the staff level, and I'm sure there are conversations with us at the policy level. This is one of the cool reasons to maybe put your regional transit concept together county by county, right? Because Henrico's in a sweet spot right now where they can see a lot of potential benefits of something that's already kind of pointed at them. But yeah, I agree completely that there are a lot of great opportunities in Henrico, there are a lot of serious needs in Henrico, and there's probably something to do. Yeah. One more. Oh, man.
Yeah. You mentioned earlier that you were already disappointed in the plan that what happened. And I'm just curious what those disappointments are. What did you want to accomplish that somehow it just didn't work?
Well, within the budget that we have to work with, I would like to have a more extensive network of red lines. I will say that network of red lines that I showed you, which was from our first pass, we're not going to be able to afford all of them. It's going to be a little bit less than that, and that's disappointing. So we're having to make some hard choices about that. I hate to stop.
No, it's great questions. I'd like to ask one since I have the mic. You alluded at the very beginning that there's a tension between, you know, the adoption of driverless cars and, you know, car ride sharing and that sort of thing. Can you elaborate just a little bit on that space question that you were talking about? And what do we, you know, what does a public transit advocate say to those who say, you know, that's antiquated thinking, you should be looking at, you know, X technology now instead of that?
So remember, what public relations wants to do is mix a whole bunch of things together to get you excited and confused. And you have to have the discipline to take those things apart. And a lot of what we're dealing with, there's a lot of brilliance and brilliant innovation going on, but there's also a lot of just public relations problem. So a solution to a space problem is one that takes more people in fewer space, in less space. Okay? That is not any kind of car. Now, it is some sort of larger vehicle operated in a pattern where lots of people might use. Even Elon Musk gets these things. You can find an old article of mine called, a recent article of mine, called Does Elon Musk Understand Earth Geology? The implied answer is what I'm not sure. It's got to be a vehicle with more people in it, and therefore much fewer vehicles if you're going to use urban space. The driverless car people will say, but our cars will push together. And that's sort of like, it's a small solution, but that doesn't begin to approach how well buses work, or trains at doing the same. So the thing to remember is that there are different problems that are being solved by different technologies, and you've got to keep them separate. So there is a problem of emissions and energy efficiency for which the answer is electric vehicles. That solves that problem. There's a problem of safety and also a problem of labor efficiency that is solved by driverlessness of any kind of vehicle. And then there is a problem of space, which is solved by large vehicles with more people on them. Those are three different problems. Don't let people confuse you. Stop and think. When somebody presents a whiz-bang thing to you, stop and think about which problems that's solving. Energy emissions problem, human effort and safety problem, driverlessness, space problem. You've got to be talking about something other than cars before you're talking about space.
Thank you very much. Before we leave, we have our friends from RV Rapid Transit just want to have a brief call to action here. So, Nelson and Dominic.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you all so much for being here tonight. We did want to share some specific ways that folks can be involved in pushing all of this forward, both with what's going on in the city and with what's going on regionally. There are a lot of incredible things that are happening right now to make our city and our region more accessible and prosperous through transit, as well as transit-oriented development. And everybody in your seat had two handouts, a blue one and a green one. If you look at the blue one, these are three specific ways that we can be involved. The very first one is reaching out to council members, council candidates, and mayoral candidates in support of the Richmond Transit Network Plan. And there are going to be emails coming out from us on this front, so just keep your eyes out for those. But you can also feel fully free to embark on that on your own at will.
And the second one that you'll see, by the way, this is Nelson Reevely, who is the president of RVA Rapid Transit, and I'm Dominic Carter, who's the vice president of RVA Rapid Transit. And we just wanted to say thank you for that presentation, Jarrett Walker. That was awesome. Appreciate that. Number two is plan to participate and invite others to participate in the final public input meetings for the Richmond Transit Network Plan in January 2017. And then to number three, join the civic statement of support for regional transit, as we talked about, and support the regional transit vision plan among friends, colleagues, and our local leaders.
And we'll just, Trevor, you can click it one more forward. So this is just some of the folks, some of the organizations and institutions that have signed on to the civic statement of support so far. And we're clearly just trying to continue to grow that list because the regional system is only going to happen when we're all asking for it together. And we're just going to read it passionately for you here before we go. It reads like this. We call on the leaders of our jurisdictions to unite in creating a first-class public transportation system for the entire metropolitan region. We believe that all should have the opportunity to live in mutual prosperity in constructive relationships, in educated diversity, in justice, and in hope for the future.
We know that linking metropolitan Richmond together with a public transportation system would significantly increase people's access to employment, workforce development, commerce, higher education, nutritious food, and routine health care.
It would enhance the quality of life for all, including those seeking to maintain freedom of mobility as they age. And as has been demonstrated in other metro areas, good regional transit would also attract young talent, increase property values, and spur robust investment and economic development while helping to sustain the environment.
We know we can vault to the top 10% of American metro areas in public transportation by building a comprehensive system, such as one identified by transportation planners and RVA Rapid Transit. We join together across jurisdictions, asking our leaders to unite without delay in this common constructive cause.
So yes, you can see all that on the website. You can see all these groups on the website. Spread the word. And let's all thank Jarrett one more time.